Welcome to our fourth segment of Weather Wednesdays. I am meteorologist Kevin Skroup, and if you haven't been involved, we have been kind of going through kind of Weather 101 over the last couple of months, and last month talked more about nature and weather, and so each month we essentially pick a topic here on the internet version of Weather Wednesdays. Today we're going to talk about hurricanes, which we don't talk about much during the course of an entire year. It's usually August and September, maybe early October for us is kind of our window of time. And so we're going to discuss that today. And obviously, they can have a very high impact if something takes the perfect track, has the perfect intensity. But for the most part, it's something we talk about just in a certain time of year as opposed to all year long, something like floods, for instance. And so what we do is, if you haven't been involved with this before, we have the live wire section up here on our website. You can ask a question, and after my 10 or 15 minute presentation about hurricanes, we'll show you our past here in hurricanes and what the forecast is for this season, what it might mean for us here in New Hampshire. I will answer those questions for you right here on our live wire section, and we'll get you going here. And we'll start off with a little bit of a discussion on our weather history here in New Hampshire. And it is a fairly sordid history. About every 10 to 15 years, we have some semblance of a tropical system come in here, and they will go either between just heavy rain or the possibility of all things as far as heavy rain, gusty winds, and a lot of power outages because of that. So let's head right into our presentation here. And again, we're calling it kind of the past, present, and uncertain future, because in forecasting, that's pretty much what it is for us out there. So what I'm going to do is talk about in general what hurricanes mean for us here in New Hampshire. Our main window of time, even though hurricane season goes from June 1st to November 30th, is essentially August as well as September and October. The height of hurricane season for the entire Atlantic Basin, which is what we're concerned about, is around September 10th. And so anywhere from about the second half of August through about the first half of October is when most of our tropical systems we contend with and deal with. Now, there could be some tropical moisture left over from a weak tropical system in the Gulf of Mexico that gets swept up by a cold front in July, so there is that potential, or sometime in November as well. But in general, we're talking the tropical systems that kind of have a center of circulation that hold together and kind of move towards us. There are two types of threatening tropical systems for us. One, a slow-moving heavy rainmaker like tropical remnants of Tammy, which occurred in October of 2005. We'll talk more about that in a minute. Or Irene, which gave a tremendous amount of rainfall to central and northern areas of the state when it came calling several years ago. Or it could be the full-fledged hurricane, where it has the wind and the rainfall to go along with it. The Hurricane of 38, just celebrating its 75th anniversary last year. Hurricane Carol, that happened in 1954, which is the last time we had a widespread wind of 100 miles an hour. And Hurricane Bob that happened in 1991. A couple of our past hurricanes we can talk about here, and here's the main statistic I always point to whenever I talk to anybody about this. The Hurricane of 38 basically knocked down one out of every three trees in New England. That is the standout statistic from this storm. It was a fast-moving, penetrating storm all the way up through New England. Some of the heaviest damage we had in the entire state was actually in the White Mountain National Forest, which was really decimated almost completely by this hurricane. It was off the coast of North Carolina one day and then up in Montreal, Canada the next. So it was a fast mover, and of course this before satellite pictures, radar images, TV, weather geeks, and so there wasn't a tremendous amount of warning that this was coming, and I don't know if that necessarily really would have helped in this situation. It's probably a worst case scenario as far as emergency management is concerned. In talking to them about this potential scenario actually ever happening again, they worry about people who live out in the woods, basically, away from, you know, city streets, that sort of thing, of being without power and isolated for over 4 to 6 weeks from something like this as far as scattered power outages are concerned. And that's the one thing we look at with these kind of possibilities of a system, is essentially a situation where we live in, per capita, one of the most forested states in the country. And there's a beauty to that, but at the same time, there's a price to be paid for that. We can't cut around every single power line across the state, and so when you have a widespread wind of over 120 miles an hour, there's going to be a tremendous amount of damage from this. And so many trees fell from the Hurricane of 38 that they set up makeshift sawmills around area ponds around the state. There was a book written several years ago called They Sawed Up a Storm, which talked about Turkey Pond and how they laid out all this sawed off wood over the lakes of several ponds here in the state of New Hampshire, basically in a way to make sure that that wood wouldn't just rot out in the woods, that it would actually be preserved until a sawmill could be put together and take care of it. Well, in the late 30s, we were in war at the time, and so it was tough to get manpower back at that time, but gradually and through most part of it, it is one of those scenarios that we were able to at least preserve a lot of that wood. Turkey Pond, where the New Hampshire Audubon Society is, you can actually take a walk around that. There's those docks you can go out onto, and if the lake level is low enough, you can kind of get maybe a view of a couple of these sawed-off logs. This is a picture of one of those there at Turkey Pond. Kind of a historical number here is to look at the Merrimack River level, and you can see with that hurricane of 38, second highest, just bested by a couple of years earlier, the flood of 36, which has an amazing historical significance for the Mill District here in Manchester and how high that was back at that time. It had been a very wet summer leading up to that as well, which also plays into a traumatic effect of it. We know how active our pattern has been over the last 7, 8, 9 years. The beginnings of that was the Alstead flood that happened in western parts of the state. As you can see, the heaviest of the rainfall focused in western parts of the state. Some areas over a foot of rain in 2.5 to 3 days. This was the remnants of Tropical System Tammy that got absorbed into this system. And that is, again, one of the two big threats, is the very heavy rain. Inland flooding is not something a lot of people talk about when they think or imagine of a hurricane, but they think storm surge, they think gusty winds, they think beach erosion. But that inland flooding, especially when that storm does slow down or continue to make its way inland fairly slow moving, can be a real issue when you get a foot, foot and a half of rain in a very small amount of time. Other tropical systems that are in our sorted history here, Carol, on August 31st, 1954, had a lot of wind with it. As a matter of fact, that's the last time we've had a widespread 100 mile per hour wind in our state here in New Hampshire. And you have to think, you go back now essentially 60 years since that has occurred, trees have been allowed to grow without that kind of what we'll call natural clear-cutting element involved that hurricanes can give you. Now, bear in mind, you had Carol, and then just 12 days later, you had Edna come calling, and that was a much weaker system. It didn't have the tremendous amount of wind that Carol did, but obviously you have two tropical systems within 12, 13 days of each other. There was some pretty big flooding coming from that. A lot of folks, even people in their middle ages of life now, can remember Bob pretty easily from 1991. That obviously a lot of damage toward the seacoast as it made its closest pass to us across Cape Cod. There was a hurricane in 1944 that also packed a pretty good punch, and Gloria in 1985, something much akin to Bob that people can remember quite easily. Want to talk a little bit about hurricane forecasting. Now, this gives you an example of all the different computer models, and there are sometimes going when there is a big tropical system out there active anywhere between 20 to 30 different types of computer maps. They all run on different math equations, so they're going to give you different solutions on a track of a tropical system. And you can see how for the first few days of this track, Sandy expected to lift northward through the Bahama chains. Now, as it continued to lift northward from there, that's where some of the computer maps started to move away from that consensus of north. A lot of those, in the bulk of the hurricane maps, faded out to sea, while there were several others, 5, 6 others, that had that still as a possibility for the East Coast. And as you can see here, if you were to take the average of those 5 or 6, essentially the Northeast. Now, as we know how this all unfolded, there was only 1 or 2 tracks that were pretty close to where this happened. And that is why when you get within 5 or 6 days of a tropical system just being what we'll call possible for our area, it is one of those things that we just kind of keep you updated on the forecast as we get closer. We are beholden to a lot of these maps 5, 6, 7 days away. That's kind of where the technology is today. But it just wanted to show you the weaknesses in these maps, and they certainly are by no means infallible. And at the same time, when we show you that error cone, it is real. And it is something that you should watch, the cone and not the exact center of where that cone is eventually taking you. So where do we stand as far as the forecasting is concerned from something like our tropical systems? And this is always the tricky part. And if you've watched a couple of these others, I've talked about seasonal forecasting being very difficult. And we'll talk about one of the X factors of last season, which was supposed to be a very active season for us, in just a minute. The official NOAA forecast for 2014 has 8 to 13 named storms. Our normal average, going all the way back to when we've been keeping records, is around 12 for the Atlantic Basin. Hurricanes, about 3 to 6, which is on the lower end of that seasonal average, and below average as far as major hurricanes. Now, I want you to bear in mind, yes, that means that it would be a slightly below average season, assuming this forecast were to come true. But at the same time, you get into a situation where it only takes one wandering up the East Coast to make it a busy season for you. So that's what we're looking at here is, again, you kind of look at the general scope of things and say, okay, we're heading into an El Nino type pattern this summer, and that usually means lesser activity in the Atlantic. Last year, 15 named storms, but only two of those named storms actually strengthened to a hurricane, and no major hurricanes. Now, we remember the forecast from last year, expected to be quite active, and it was, at least as far as the named storms are concerned, but there was a little bit of an X factor, and this is what I mean by seasonal forecasting and how we're not quite to the point yet where we're getting exactly where we need to be in all the different factors and how they're easily predicted more than 4, 6, 8 weeks away. There was a lot of dry air that was out of the Saharan deserts, and that eventually weeded its way into the tropical waves coming off Africa. And as those waves came off Africa, they weren't as moist, they didn't have as much energy with them, and that dry air really choked them off, essentially. And so that dry air navigates its way all the way across the Atlantic Ocean. Quick story for you, when I worked in Florida back in the late 90s, early 2000s, there would be mornings in July, August, and September when I would come outside to my car to go to work at 2 in the morning, and I would notice after a rain there were also these little grains of sand that were on my windshield. Those are grains of sand that come all the way across the Atlantic in the mid-levels of the atmosphere where these tropical waves and tropical depressions are. And they travel all the way across and they rain themselves out over Florida and in the deep south. So that is a real situation that the forecast models have to get better at predicting. And what they didn't really predict well last year was how much dry air was going to be involved. So we had a lot of named storms last year, just not a lot of hurricanes because there wasn't a lot of strengthening going on. The other kind of upper level patterns that we look at, and again for our window of late August, September, and early October, are two things we've talked about as far as our winter season is concerned. The Arctic Oscillation brings the cold air south, and it essentially buckles the jet stream and sends the storm track well to our south for the time being. That is something that at least would help us as far as keeping us protected from any sort of tropical systems. We had plenty of this going on during the winter months. Of course, that doesn't help us in August, September, and October. It matters what it's going to do during those 10 or 11 weeks of that main window of time. The other thing we look at is over Greenland, and if there's going to be what we call blocking, basically an upper-level traffic jam in the atmosphere. And if there is, you essentially have a conduit or a jet stream that will basically go right up the East Coast. There's two, as I described, there are two ways a storm system can go when it gets to the coast of North Carolina. It can head right out to sea, west to east, like a lot of storms do, or it can turn around and then head right up the East Coast. And with that blocking going on in Greenland, it sets up kind of that weather traffic jam where those lows can come right up the coast and eventually toward New England. So you can see how those two upper level patterns, while they seem far removed over the Arctic or over Greenland, can have a huge effect as to what our weather is going to be. As we get longer and longer with our records, and for Concord, for instance, we go all the way back to 1870. Reliably with hurricanes, we can go back to about 1850 to have at least a decent idea in and around the lower 48 of what has actually been going on. One of the decades that was busiest for us was the 1950s. And what we know now by looking at all the cycles that happen, whether it be the sun, ocean currents, the temperatures, because of all of that and how they kind of play hand in hand, is we know that in the 1950s, the Pacific Ocean had been cooling for several years prior to that, so the late 40s, early 50s, and the Atlantic Ocean had just started to cool right around the early to mid 1950s. And so the Pacific usually cools a little bit first and then the Atlantic thereafter. Well, that's seemingly the pattern we're in right now. And I want you to just notice on this map exactly how many named storms we had in and around the East Coast from about 1950 to about 1960. Again, Carol and Edna are involved here. Hurricane Donna in 1960. You had Helene in 1958, Hazel in 1954. And so there were a lot of tropical systems back at this time. That, if you kind of look back at our last 3, 4, 5 years, seemingly kind of sets up a situation where Irene and Sandy really aren't accidents or a coincidence that we've had two named systems in that amount of time. And it kind of leads us to believe, considering in our climate right now, we're essentially in the mid-1950s, maybe a 1956, 57 type range, that we still have several years to go through this pattern that we're in, this heightened pattern that we're in, regardless of any particular season. And so this is kind of a little bit of a stressful time, just looking back at climatology, to have a really good idea as to what to anticipate, at least in the next 4 or 5 years of our future. So what can you do? You want to be prepared on any given season. A family plan is a great idea. Go over all of that enormous checklist that NewHampshire.gov has on their website of everything that you can have to be prepared, whether it's the family documents, maybe it's enough food or water for several days, maybe it's that safety kit, maybe you have certain types of medication, maybe plans for your pets. In case you get to a situation, and we've had several of these as far as our ice storm was concerned back in 2008, where the power was out in several areas for quite a while, to all the way down the line to essentially something as simple as a blizzard, which keeps you isolated for 2 or 3 days. Always a great idea to be ready for something like this. And with a hurricane, worst case scenario, 1938, there are areas without power for a month. Something like a tropical system, worst case scenario, would be flooding and certain areas isolated, especially if you live near an area river that tends to flood in even a moderate rainstorm. Those are the kind of areas, and you know where you are, and if you're on a higher hilltop versus that. If you live on a higher hilltop, you may be a little bit more prone to gustier winds than you would be the flooding. But everyone's situation is that little bit different, but you know what kind of threats, especially after the last 7 or 8 years and how crazy the weather has been around here, to what you can expect as far as that's concerned. So that's my presentation as far as today is concerned. As far as our summer and into fall is concerned, our upper level pattern, we're going to have to wait and see how everything lays out in August and September. A lot of the long range maps that we've been looking at, a lot of the predictions out there have been slightly cooler than normal for the summer, which means about a half degree cooler than normal. You may not even notice it for the most part, a half a degree, and slightly drier than normal. So that would lend itself to a little bit of a trough across the lower 40, or the eastern part of the United States, which would seemingly, yes, steer things in our general direction, but at the same time, it depends on exactly where that trough is. If it's back out toward the Great Lakes, something comes up the East Coast. If it's right overhead, it will get sent out toward the Canadian Maritimes as it comes north. So we do have a few questions up here on our live wire section, and again, feel free to send those questions to us. Will wants to know, what is the strongest hurricane that we have ever seen in New Hampshire? The hurricane of 38, again, just going over the 75th anniversary last year, is certainly one that when you knock down one out of every three trees in New England. You can go back and read stories about hurricanes from the 1600s and 1700s, but as far as recent memory is concerned, and as far as emergency management talking about a worst case scenario today, that's the one that worries them, because it is a fairly fast moving 45 miles an hour. So while Connecticut gets the brunt of it, Long Island, and they did in 1938, we still get the 120 mile an hour winds because it's holding its strength together, because it's moving faster and in our general direction. And that's something to consider as far as power outages are concerned. If we have a landfalling hurricane that hits Long Island, then Connecticut, goes up through Massachusetts and affects Vermont and New Hampshire and parts of Maine, power companies are going to have to come from much farther away than just a neighboring state to help us. So it's going to take some time, and that's why preparation, as far as having gas filled for a generator, making sure that works and keeping upkeep on that, is really important. But that essentially, as far as the storm track, its speed, and its strength, is about the worst case scenario for us here, is the hurricane of 38. Many, many books written on that, and you can see even some video out there online. Should we be worried about hurricanes this season here in New Hampshire? It only takes one, and usually it is only one for us on a given season. The numbers indicate that it may be slightly below normal as far as the entire season is concerned, but then you're talking the entire Atlantic Basin, the Gulf of Mexico, the Caribbean. So that really doesn't tell us a lot. It really matters when we get into mid to late August what the upper level pattern is going to be at that time. And much like winter forecasting in October or November, and how the upper level pattern is going to be, and how those two oscillations that we talked about over Greenland or the North Pole are going to be by mid-December and into January and February, 3 or 4 months later, it is a really tough thing to do. But as we get into August, we're going to start seeing that upper level pattern on the maps, and we'll see how fixed it's been over the summer, how semi-permanent that Bermuda high is, and if it's willing to move around and if it's going to be more changeable. And that certainly helps. So every year is its own roll of the dice as far as we're concerned. But again, the 1950s thing is what I go back to. And just thinking the next 5 or 6 years, it doesn't mean we're going to see something. But when you look back at our history, it wouldn't be surprising in any way, shape, or form. Has Dr. Gray out in Colorado come up with his own predictions yet? And if so, how does it compare to Noah's? He officially has retired from doing predictions, but the Colorado State University Center there still does their predictions. And I believe in taking a quick glance at that about 2 or 3 weeks ago, it looked like their predictions were fairly similar to what NOAA has for this. Now, they don't necessarily do the entire range of 8 to 13 named storms. They will key in on a certain number, as do a lot of other outlets in the same process of doing this. Most ways of predicting for this, you look at sea surface temperatures, you look at the upper level winds, you look whether we're in an El Nino or La Nina, what the water temperatures are doing. And now I think a lot of people are looking at that dry air over Africa to have a really good idea as to what the season's going to be like. How many hurricanes have made landfall in New England in the last 50 years? This is from Sally. We looked at a pretty good number of them here. Just in the last 50 years, you probably have to go beyond Carol in 1954 and Edna. So then you start to get past Donna in 1960, and you have Gloria in the mid-80s, you have Bob in 1991, and then you have Irene and Sandy. So you have four systems there in 50 years. About every 8 to 10 years is when we see a named center of circulation storm, the strong tropical storm or hurricane, make its way in here. And there are times, obviously, like the 1950s, where that is heightened and that average gets blown up completely in exactly how it works. So those are the questions here on LiveWire. And again, preparation's the key here. We have gone through a tremendous amount of storms here, whether they be blizzards, ice storms, floods over the last 7, 8, 9 years. I don't think this is like 10 years ago where we have to tell people to be prepared. I think a lot of people have taken among themselves to have a generator to be ready. But again, it's that family plan. It's just knowing what the scope of something like a hurricane of 38 or a Carol or a Bob can do to us. And then keeping updated on the forecasts and knowing that the forecasts 7, 8 days away really aren't going to tell you exactly where a tropical system is going to make landfall. Usually the biggest surprise when there is a tropical system making its way toward a landmass is if there isn't a surprise. Usually there is, whether it be with the intensity dropping or climbing right before landfall or the track moving around a little bit. And certainly a system in October like Sandy kind of doing a westward turn into the mid-Atlantic is not something we see a lot of in our hurricane history. So that was the surprise. And obviously it occurring during astronomical high tide really gave a tremendous amount more of an impact for the New Jersey coastline and the Long Island coastline from a storm coming its way through. Next month in our Weather Wednesday, we're going to be talking on July 2nd here at 1 o'clock about tornadoes and our history here in New Hampshire. It is a little known fact that almost half of our tornadoes here in New Hampshire that have been officially recorded since the records have been kept in 1950, legitimately, about half of those tornadoes happen in the month of July. And you can go all the way as early May or as late September, but all that is centered in July, so I figured that might be a good time to talk about tornadoes. If you ever have any questions on anything hurricanes or weather, you can feel free to email us right in the Weather Center at weather@WMUR.com. That comes to all of us, whoever's working on shift at that time. And thank you again for all your questions here on LiveWire, and we'll see you again next month.